Hi, I'm Dr. Brian Nickel, your cannabis expert for CannabisExpertMD.com with a rather frequently asked question. I know I've addressed it a couple times in the past, but I realize not everybody reads back a year and a half, 2 years back on the Facebook timeline feed. But Ashley from Ashdown, yeah, I did that one. I can't blame the producer. I didn't try too hard. She asked, I use two gummies at night to help me sleep. I ran out and used THC tincture, which is like taking nothing. Do you know why? Well, Ashley, you have experienced an observation that's very common in most medical cannabis patients, and that is that they see a marked difference in the response they get based on route of administration. Now, what we're going to talk about applies to all the different cannabinoids, but we're just going to use THC as our example here, since you mentioned gummy bears, and those are a THC source, essentially. Cannabis gives us all the same form of THC. It's really the difference in the body's metabolism based on route of administration that accounts for the difference of effects. The form of THC produced by the plant, the native version of it, is referred to as THCA. It's an acidic version of THC. This particular version is not psychoactive, not the use that most patients are used to experiencing with it. It may really not have a lot of the medical benefits that we're used to seeing with the Delta 9 THC variant that most patients are familiar with. It may have medical benefits, particularly with regard to inflammation, but these are currently being studied and explored. When you are using the inhalation route of administration, whether it's a combustion or dry or vaporizer, you take the lighter, you put the end of your pipe or light the end of a cigarette, or you fire up your dry or vaporizer. We're using the heat of combustion or the heat provided by the dry or vaporizer to convert the THCA into the Delta 9 THC that we're all familiar with. This is the active form of THC that is then released into the circulatory system by the lungs, where it's free to interact with our endocannabinoid system and give the effects that everybody's quite familiar with. A very small portion of this Delta 9 THC is circulated back into the liver. In the liver, it is converted to a different form of THC referred to as 11-hydroxy-THC. This particular form of THC is much more potent and longer lasting than the Delta 9 variant, but again, just a very, very small percentage of the inhaled Delta 9 is converted to this 11-hydroxy version. Now, when you consume an edible, like a gummy bear that you were referring to, the Delta 9 THC in the edible is processed through the stomach. It's transported into the intestine. It's absorbed in the intestine. Everything that's absorbed in the intestine first goes through the liver as a detoxification process. Delta 9 THC is converted into 11-hydroxy-THC in the liver. Actually, most of the Delta 9 in an edible is converted over to the 11-hydroxy version. Again, 11-hydroxy-THC is much more potent and longer-lasting, accounting for the more longer-lived and intense effects that most patients experience with edibles. Now, tinctures are kind of in between there. When they're administered underneath the tongue, sublingually, they are rapidly absorbed with a peak blood level in most patients 15 or 20 minutes. This is Delta 9 THC, which is circulating in the bloodstream and is free to interact with our endocannabinoid system. A higher percentage of tinctures seems to be converted over to the 11-hydroxy version. It could be because patients do swallow more of it. It is picked up in the gut, converted to the 11-hydroxy THC, again, more potent and longer lasting. So tinctures kind of tend to be in between the edibles and the inhaled version as far as the intensity and how long the effects last for. Whether it's administered by inhalation, tincture, or edible form, the 11-hydroxy and some of the Delta 9 THC circulates back to the liver, where it's converted to the inactive metabolite of THC, referred to as carboxy THC or THC-COOH. This, again, has no activity within the human body. It is very, very long-lived and stored in adipose fat tissues. This, incidentally, is a metabolite that is identified in urine drug screens, and the long-lived nature of it, where it can be detected 4 to 6 weeks after administration of THC, makes it not very useful for determining whether a person was impaired by THC, for instance, an automobile accident. All it really does is indicate past use of it. Now, as far as edibles do go, there are some issues with this. Most patients who've used edibles will say that there's a lot of variables with this with respect to the onset of the effects. When do they set up on you? How intense the effects of oral cannabinoids are going to be, and how long they seem to last. There are a lot of reasons for these issues, but it all comes down to being it really that cannabinoids are not water soluble. This is the reason that tinctures are administered in oil or alcohol forms. Edible cannabinoids must be absorbed from the intestines to have their effect, and absorption from the intestine is affected by many different factors. As with all medications, the most important thing is individual patient variability. We all react to medications differently, of course. Underlying diseases can have an effect on gastric absorption of cannabinoids. Diabetic patients often have gastroparesis. This is where the stomach takes a lot longer to empty its contents in the intestine than with a normal patient. Patients like this can see a very, very long delay from the time a edible is administered to where they start feeling the effects. Patients with histories of bariatric surgery, this is surgery done for morbid obesity, whether it's a lap band, a gastric sleeve, or an intestinal bypass procedure. This can affect gastric emptying as well as absorption characteristics, again, making edibles somewhat difficult for these patients to typically use. The fat content of the last meal and the timing of it are really critical to determining how well these edibles are going to be absorbed. Again, with the cannabinoids not being water soluble, a high fat content ensures that a lot of the cannabinoids are going to be absorbed by the intestine, transported to the liver for metabolism. So, in order to maximize the effectiveness and avoid the side effects of edibles, it is really imperative that patients keep a journal. A journal is going to allow you to really determine the most effective dose for you as a unique individual. In your journal, you should record the effectiveness of the medication that you're using for symptoms that you're trying to address, the degree of euphoria experienced, how high you get. Remember, from a medical perspective, the euphoric effects are a side effect. You have to keep close track of the time of your last meal and the fat content of that, and how long it really lasts you as far as the duration of effects you're seeking. It is going to be crucial that you are consistent with the timing of your edible dose with your last meal. I usually recommend patients either consume their edible at the time of the meal or within 30 minutes to ensure that the cannabinoids are going to be absorbed at the same time as food that is consumed. The higher the fat content of the meal, the more the cannabinoids you are going to absorb. One thing that patients always have to be aware of when you're determining the appropriate edible dose is to be aware that at some point or another, as you're searching for the appropriate dose, the time of administration, and the meal content, it's likely at some point you are going to experience effects well in excess of that you were trying to get. Essentially, you're going to be overserved and you might feel too high. You don't want to be doing this on a day you have a PTA conference or a meeting with a judge scheduled, so be sure you plan accordingly. One of the things that I'm always suggest to patients when they're using edibles, especially if you're not using much CBD in your regimen to treat your condition, is to consider having some available to you, whether it be in CBD flower form or tincture form. The administration of additional CBD, if you do end up being overserved and experience euphoric effects well in excess of what you're trying to get, these can be moderated by the administration of additional CBD.
What about Buffalo Coke?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Producer. Just to remind everybody, Buffalo Co. is offering all of our patients a 25% discount through the end of the month here with the code CEMD25. I guess there's just a couple days left on that. I have been talking to them, and we're going to plan on hopefully running a contest with some of their products soon, and hopefully there'll be some more discount codes for you in the future here.
Also, don't forget about Big Chief. We're going to be doing his stuff soon.
Well,
Yeah.
and my number one son and favorite producer Samuel just reminded me that we are going to be starting a new series up. We have a cat around the house. He's the big chief, and he's not necessarily the best cat around. we're going to be trying some CBD on him and see if we can improve his attitude a little bit and his behavior around the house. So be sure to check for that series. I think it might be fun and interesting at any rate. For more information on all things medical cannabis, we're always available right here on Facebook under Cannabis Expert MD. Also check us out at CannabisExpertMD.com, on Instagram, YouTube, and Twitter under the Cannabis Expert MD handle.